Blackstone Audio presents Under Cold Stone, a Constable Molly Smith mystery by Vicki Delany. This book is read by Carrington MacDuffie. To Cheryl Friedman, friend. Toad that under cold stone days and nights has 31 sweltered venom sleeping got. Boil thou first in the charmed pot. William Shakespeare, Macbeth, Act 4, Scene 1. Chapter 1. A cafe, Banff, Alberta, Friday morning. The scent of warm baking and fresh coffee was enticing enough to have Lucky Smith willing to endure the cafe's long line. She rubbed her hands against the chill and shuffled forward. Another couple of paces and she'd be through the doors at last. Paul Keller had taken one look at the orderly crowd of tourists and locals in search of caffeine and cookies and said he'd meet up with Lucky later. He wanted to check out the sports store a few doors down the street. Lucky's interest in fishing equipment was about the same as Paul's interest in $5 custom-made chai, so they arranged to go their own ways for the afternoon and meet back at the hotel in time to dress for dinner. Dress for dinner, such a quaint concept. But it did suit this vacation, their first as a couple, and the historic Banff Springs Hotel in which they were staying. Lucky was a firm believer in not spending time in your partner's pocket. Paul took his coffee black and liked Tim Hortons just fine, although in this town the Tims could have quite the lineup for coffee and donuts. And his passion was fishing. Lucky thought a chai latte one of the finest benefits of civilization, and she couldn't imagine anything more boring than fishing, unless it was discussing the merits of various types of fishing equipment with the store clerk. She was almost inside. She should have worn a coat, but as she'd planned to spend her day getting a start on her Christmas shopping and exploring the town, she'd thought a thick hand-woven sweater would have been sufficient. The Rocky Mountains in October. As a mountain resident herself, Lucky should have remembered how changeable the weather could be. The person in front of her, a fashionably dressed woman pushing a chair containing a dozing toddler, made it to the doors. The chair holding the child was, Lucky thought, almost large enough to house a third-world family. When did children's chairs become homes on wheels, anyway? When she was a young mother, more years ago than she cared to remember, Lucky had a push chair for her children that folded up into the size of an umbrella, a seat on wheels with a handle. That was all. This one had plush seating, padded sides, a folding canopy, two cup holders, for the parents, not the child. Wide enough to fit toys, drinks, and snacks, and shopping bags, as well as a toddler, with an extra bag slung on the back in case of an emergency purchase. The woman wrestled her child's mobile home over the ledge and into the shop. Lucky held the door. The young mother didn't bother to thank her. Lucky considered saying something, but bit her tongue. She was on vacation, after all. Deep in thought about the lack of manners these days, she was almost knocked off her feet as a man shoved against her. She stumbled and fell to the floor. The man attempted to force his way past Lucky, but she thrust her arm out, blocking the entrance. "There's a line!" He was in his 30s, tall but scrawny, with scraggy blonde hair and hostile blue eyes that bored into her. Thin lips, a scab in the right bottom corner, formed the words, "Fuck off, lady." She blinked in surprise. "There's a line up here," she repeated. "Please wait your turn."
"Where are you from?" he snarled.
"I don't, that's relevant." Her heart started beating faster. She studied his eyes for any sign of current drug use. His pupils were normal-sized, the whites slightly red, but more perhaps from a late night than overindulgence. His eyes would be an attractive dark blue if they didn't overflow with aggression and a sense of entitlement. The young mother glanced over her shoulder to see what was going on, and then she dipped her head and shoved her child further into the cafe. Lucky couldn't blame her. She had a child to care for. Lucky stepped forward to stand on the threshold, blocking the entrance. The man lifted his chin and thrust his chest out. He was considerably taller than she, at 5 foot nothing, most people were, and loomed over her.
"Bitch," he mouthed.
She broke eye contact to glance around, seeking some support. The young couple immediately behind her had their arms wrapped around each other, heads close, eyes for nothing but the objects of their affection.
The head of the man behind them was bent, thumbs moving rapidly as he tapped out a message on his smartphone. The line snaked down the sidewalk. Couples chatted and people listened to their iPods or sent vitally urgent messages on their own phones. The space in front of Lucky was now clear. She did not move. No point in standing her ground and risking confrontation if the rude man would then slip in behind her. A second man, shorter but beefier, stood slightly behind the first. "What's your problem?" he asked, his voice low.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.